maybe at the end we all can smile.
That sounds good. So Doron, let me say...
I'm smiling now. I'm so disappointed because we did everything working yesterday and I just changed places from home to work to the office. But it is history. Okay. I'm all set and ready.
All right. Well, we're looking at a beautiful aerial view of Jerusalem looking north.
Okay. So, can we start?
Yes, we can start.
Okay, let me just shut the door here, just one moment. Okay. Here I start. The story of the Akra, the story of actually the Henyon Givati excavation, has to do first and foremost in its location. And the location of the Givati parking lot, and now whenever I say click here, guys, you need to click once to see the location of the Givati parking lot. You see the arrow and you see the Givati parking lot location. If you don't see, just say if you don't see, so I can... are you with me?
Yeah, we can see it.
Do you see it? Do you see the arrow, the red arrow and the location of the Givati parking lot?
Yes, we do.
Relating to the Temple Mount. Okay, so if you see it, you understand that the Givati parking lot is actually located south of the Temple Mount, actually touching the foot of the Temple Mount in the south. And today it is, I would say, the closest area currently excavated, closest to the Temple Mount. And we need to understand the significance of the location later while trying to interpret, understand whether our interpretation of the location makes any sense in terms of height, topography, etc., etc. So the Givati parking lot, which is currently the largest excavation, one of the largest excavations ever opened in Jerusalem, not only in the city of David. And now we click again, and you can see now the actual area of excavations in yellow. And you see that it is rather a large excavation area. And again, the location now at the foot of the Temple Mount is clearly visible. Now, it is highly important to understand that it is not only the location so close to Temple Mount that counts, but also, and please click again, it is also topography that counts, because the Givati parking lot is located on the highest spot on this very hill, which is known as the City of David Hill. And if you now following my slide, I'm looking at the Givati parking lot, which is running through in yellow. I hope you can see with area G just for orientation. I guess we all know where area G is located. So you see the area G is facing the sloped box deeply to the Kizomret. So I hope you all see on the left hand side, you see how deep the Kidron is, and the Givati parking lot is actually is located on the other side of the hill, on the highest most part of this hill, and you don't see it, but you have to believe what I'm telling you now, that on the other side of the hill, which actually is correlated with the western, which is to your right side, to the western perimeter of the Givati excavation. So basically the road that you are looking at right now in the center is the highest most part of the hill. To your left you see how it drops to the Kidron Valley. While on the west end, where the Givati parking lot starts, it has almost the same steepness, and it drops and it falls to another valley that you all know it by the two of your own valley name, by the Israeli name. If you are trying to see where the Kirabon Valley runs, you don't see it here. But one of the important contribution of the excavation at the Givati parking lot is the actual location of the Kirabon Valley, which is again equivalent with the western part of the excavation area. Are you all with me thus far? Do you all see the slides, the photo that I'm looking at? Are we all correlated with this photo?
Yes, we are.
Yeah, it is very strange. I've never seen it before. This is the first time that I talk to the computer, actually. But if you are all there with me, so we can proceed. So, again, just summarizing these 2 points. One of them is the location of the excavation area, close, very close, as you could see, to the Temple Mount, and second, on the highest point of the city of David Hill. With these two on your mind, we can move on. And now we click again, and you now are looking on a general view of the excavation. Don't try to make any sense of what you're looking because there are so many walls, so many strata, so many different things which are not really relevant to the issue under discussion here. But if you click again, you'll see this.
Is it possible to enlarge the slides? Is it possible to enlarge the slides?
It's showing on presenter view for those of us remotely, and if you take it off of presenter view, it'll be full size, I think.
Oh, it's looking at the wrong screen.
Click one of the other buttons on the bottom, maybe.
If everything is okay, give me green light, and I can continue.
Oh, hold on,
You will.
Doron, hold on 1 second. People are getting caught up.
I sent the PowerPoint to Donald. Donald can easily distribute it to everybody.
Oh, I think we're all right here.
We're fixing it right now.
Okay, so I can have my coffee here and relax.
To go on to slideshow.
Disappointed I am. I had everything only could not think about the only one thing that the connection here.
Yes, there you go.
You got it.
Yeah, okay. Can you, go ahead.
Can we continue?
Yeah.
Need to resume the presenter. We're back on.
You're still just seeing this screen, right?
Do you all see the screen or not yet?
Yeah. I see the aerial view. There we go.
We're seeing that they're seeing something else.
So did you guys figure out how to see it bigger?
I see a very thick wall there.
Okay. So we're caught up with you now, Doron. You can keep on going.
Okay. So should I continue?
You should continue.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I guess that we are all looking at the excavation area in general, and then you can see the yellow rectangular to focus your attention on the relevant remains.
Correct.
Now, if you click again carefully, you see that only the relevant, just making sure that you are looking at the relevant remains, are now visible to your eyes. Generally speaking, let me describe what we are looking at. At the center, diagonally running, you see a tower. Ignore all the holes inside. I will speak later on about all the cavities that you are looking at that irritating the eye, but ignore them. They are all mikveh and ritual baths and other installations that were later cut into earlier remains. So while understanding this saying of mine, you can see that the whole thing is the center, which is rather big. You see the person standing on the lower part, on the foreground of the photo, just for the scale. So you see that we are dealing with a rather large feature, which is the tower. On the left side, which is westward, this is outside the city of David Hill. Okay? This is outside the city, outside whatever, in terms of fortification, because if this is a tower, somewhere a bit higher and to your right, you see a very wide wall, which was in turn also cut by a large installation. It is on your top right side. Try to locate in your eyes the city wall. It is on the upper right side of the photo, and it is cut by a large mikveh. This is the large cavity in the upper right side of this photo. So altogether you have a city wall and you have a tower. And this tower and city wall are located now in terms of topography on the highest part of the hill in its western side. Immediately in your mind you need to duplicate it and try to understand that on the eastern side of the city of David Hill, it must have the same feature, meaning city wall and maybe towers, and we'll get to the eastern side later on. Now we are trying to understand the significance of the discovery here in the Givati project. So only in this respect, uncovering remains of fortification on the city of David Hill. On its western side, this is enough to make us, we excavators, excavating the city of David Hill, thrilled by this discovery. Now, the second question that immediately arises is, of course, chronology. Okay, we have these features of city wall, and we have this tower, and I will show you the glacis in a moment. The question of chronology immediately arises, and I will get to the question of chronology immediately, and I guess Donald has something also to contribute in this respect. So, if we click one more, you can see these remains much larger presented here in this photo. Please pay attention that in the center of the photo, the white color that immediately appears in the center is actually a bedrock. And bedrock here is to say that the city wall originally was oriented to the highest part of the bedrock a moment before it dropped steeply to the Tiroperon, not the Kidron, to the Tiroperon valley on the west. Okay? Later the rock was cut in later periods, so you don't see the original layout, of course, of the rock, but I can tell you, following this line of the rock, this is exactly the point where it stops and drops steeply, and then you excavate meters and meters over and you don't see bedrock at all. So this is also something that we need to bear in mind, because later when we see the whole picture, when I open widely the lens of the camera and you see the whole hill with this fortification line, and I will put the equivalent line on the east, on the eastern part, you'll see that we are not dealing with a city here, but with something else. Okay? So here, this is another thing to bear in mind. The fortification system that was uncovered on the western part of the city of David here is located on the highest, most part, just a moment before the topography steeply drops to westward into the Tiroperon Valley. If you have questions, or would you like me to continue with this lecture of mine? Tell me whenever, guys, okay?
Yeah, I'm good. Is anybody here?
No.
It's very clear so far, and the photos are gorgeous.
Beautiful. Really.
Yeah. So
I continue. Click one more, please. Again. Okay, click one more. And now this photo is from north to south. I know that it is very puzzling to understand everything, but later you all hopefully have the PowerPoint if you like to later go through the different photos and to understand it better. So remember that this photo is presenting here the city wall. It is 3 meters wide. You see one line on the right, which is west, one line of large rocks on the left side, which is east. I told you about the cavity in the center that cuts through. This is a mikveh in the center. A mikveh that cuts through the city wall, and it is very helping because even before we have any other finds to support the dating, we know that it went out of use in the first century BC. Because these mikvehs and other water installations that are all dated to the first century BC cut through all the fortification remains that were uncovered here. So we know in this respect, we know when it definitely went out of use. The only question is when it functioned. And I'm very careful here. I'm not saying when it was built originally, but at least when these all elements function together simultaneously. So we have a tower, we have a city wall. You are looking at the city wall right now. This is only the very foundation, the lower part of the foundation that were preserved here. By the way, on the upper right side of the photo, this is a Roman period wall, so ignore it. It, of course, has like nothing to do with the issue and the discussion. So this
Doron, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, absolutely.
I have a question about the construction of the wall. So I'm looking at a line of stones that are just below the mikvah that was cut into the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And so that line of stones is kind of largish, and it runs from one side of the wall to the other. And my question is this a feature of the construction of the wall, that it was built in kind of like compartments? And then inside the compartments...
No. If I understand your question correctly, it was built as two large, two rows in each side, as you can see, consisting of very huge boulders and rocks. And in the center, all this dump of rubble and stones and dirt, etc., etc. And this is part of the construction of the foundation. We have no idea how the upper part, of course, looks like.
Right.
By the way, today, and hopefully I will convince you that this city wall at least stood 8 or 10 meters higher than this point that you're looking at, and probably even higher. Later on, you'll see what is the basis for this reconstruction of height. Now, for your question, this is only the foundation, and this is the way it was built. And from into the heart of this wall, this mikveh was cut. Now, there is a question that I don't know if we would like to get into it right now. The people who cut the mikveh actually cut it after the wall was already dismantled, dissolved, etc.? Or are they the one that cut through the wall, or are they the one responsible for this preservation of the wall, and then they cut into it, or when they cut the wall was already robbed and preserved to this low preservation height? This is something that I cannot answer with a definite answer right now. My gut say that it was already rubbed, and when in the first century BCE a new layout was established here in this part of the city, they all, these people in the first century BCE could not see the wall, and the wall was already rubbed to its very height, the same height that we are looking at right now. I hope I answered your question.
You did. Thank you very much.
Okay, more questions. I guess that sometimes I... preliminary understanding of the findings. By the way, these are the later findings, that hit the news, I don't know, 6 months ago, even more. The excavations are not running right now. We took a break. It is almost 3 or 4 months that we don't excavate. So basically today, this is what people can see when they get to the site. So we had no progress since the news broke. Okay, so let's have another clip, and then you will be able to see the person in blue shirt. I hope you all see this person.
Yes,
this is a sign for me that we are looking at the same guy. And he is standing on the tower.
Uh-huh.
And now try to remember what you looked at a moment ago. The city wall is at his back. Ignore the wall that he is leaning against, because it is Roman, late Roman period. So once you make this wall transparent, you'll be able to see the city wall on the other side, running in his back.
Yes.
Okay, good. So now you understand that he is standing on the tower, facing outside. If you just, again, ignore all the remains to the left, of the photo, this person standing originally on the tower could see the Tyropion Valley approximately 30-35 meters in front of him, meaning he's facing westward. Okay?
Okay.
So you understand that the different elements that were uncovered consist again of tower, city wall. And now, with your permission, take another click. And now you see the same person standing on the western edge of the tower. Uh-huh. Now you can see the glacis.
Yeah.
You can see the different layers sloping steeply to the Tyropion Valley. Again, ignore the lower remains that immediately catch the eye. They are, of course, earlier. They were sealed by these layers and layers of glaciers, but clearly running and looting the tower.
Right.
Hope we are all good. Now, the coming slides, they are all something to do with the tower and the glaciers. So take another click. This, how it started. You need to understand, now I open parentheses, I was asking myself how this presentation should be like. Should I describe the whole process of understanding the discovery, the essence and the and significance of the discovery, or just have it as is, the main features, and I decided to pick the first option. So what we are looking at, it's the very beginning of our understanding or misunderstanding at the beginning of what we are excavating, because at the beginning, because the excavation area is so large, we decided to actually divide this large area into 4 squares. One square was excavated, and then we started anew from topsoil all the way down, trying to see if the result from the previous excavation area can be confronted with a new square that was open, and then another quarter was open, and so forth. four such areas that that are forming the Givati Pratilot were excavated by us. You are looking now at the feature that was excavated on while excavating the third. It appeared, and we had no idea what it is. We were just making fun that maybe it is part of a glacis, because when you see such a deep feature, which is blasted, the white is blasted, that runs from diagonally, from top to bottom, with no explanation how come it appeared in this form, in your excavation area, I mean in our excavation area, and it is cut from anything. It has nothing to be related with, so we ended by saying that we don't understand this feature. Probably there will be no understanding whatsoever later, even when we accomplish the whole excavation here in the Givati parking lot. The only thing that we could say is that probably it is Hellenistic, because there are, take another click, there are millions of sheds, they are all homogeneously Hellenistic, lying below it. By the way, we had to use 5 kilos sledgehammer to break the plaster on the upper part, and still we had no idea what it originally belonged to. You can see the whole surrounding, it is connected with nothing. And the leather is leaning against the edge of the fourth square to be excavated later on. When we excavated this part, we understood exactly what this diagonal feature belongs to.
Doron, I just want to say that this looks exactly like Stratum 7 in Area G.
Okay, we'll get to Area G.
Okay.
So let's take another clip. And you see this nice lady leaning against the face, the western face of the tower. This is not the city wall, this is the tower. And you see all these layers from this side. We were lucky that this part was preserved, because nowhere else, as you could notice, the glacis was preserved. It was cut by later construction, Romans, Byzantine, etc., etc. But somehow, on this very spot, it preserved. Now, you're looking at one side of the glacis, and if you take another click, it will tell you that all the different layers that consist of stones, rubble, and you'll see another better photo later, sometimes had blunted layer that was actually it's chalk, it is not plaster, chalk that was brought and put here on one layer just to hold everything intact, and then another layer of stone, then rubber, sometimes only a layer of potfishes, and then again we could see that another layer of plaster was added, and so forth and so forth. And take another click, now you're looking at the Givati parking lot on the same. I hope you understand that the lady with red shirt, I hope you all see
yes.
The lady in red shirt, so we know that we're looking at the same photo. She's standing on the glacis. Now, you know everything else. Everything that your eyes are trying to make sense here probably don't belong, except the glacis. You see at the back of the lady, you see the tower.
Yeah, that's
this
amazing.
This is the tower at the back. Okay. Another click will bring you close to the glacis from this side. Now we're looking from north to south. Take another click. Here's our salam, standing against the glacis. You see the different layers. I hope you see the different layers.
Yeah.
They consist of different elements. And it was a question at the beginning, before we understood what we are excavating. We knew that it is Hellenistic because you just see the millions of pottery sheds that can be visible anywhere on here on the glacis. You don't see it here, you'll see it later. And they all speak in one clear language in terms of chronology. They speak loudly, we are Hellenistic by definition. There was nothing to break this definition because they were only Hellenistic sheds here in the glacis. Take another click, let's get closer. And then you see that the layers consist of sometimes ash. It means there is organic, burnt organic material that was brought in. And you see that it is not shed in all these layers. There is one nice layer that you can have your eyes follow in the center, the ash. I hope you can see if the quality of my PowerPoint with you guys can afford you the option to see that there are another such lines of burnt material. In between, you can see that there are different layers. Each of the layers is homogeneous, meaning it is not mixed, not stones, large stones with small pebbles and pottery and ash. You see ash layer, dirt. You don't see it from here, but take my word, sometimes it's only nice layer of pottery shells that were brought here and smashed to small pieces, and then large stones, and it repeats itself again and again. What I'm trying to say, this is not rubbish that was dumped from the upper part of the hill. This is not how garbage dumped looked like. And it was deliberately brought here to have this feature, this glacis, be part of the fortification system. Take another click. Another view on the glacis from now from the Jordan Valley, which is the west, on the west, from west to east. We are now the attackers. We are trying to attack the city. And we inside, as you can see, that what is missing here in the photo, and I hope that my explanation can do the work, there were other layers of dirt, exactly as you could see a moment ago in the section above. It is here after they were excavated by us. So these stones are not, this is not a dump, this is not a collapse, this is part of another layer in this feature, meaning the glacis.
Doron?
Doron, take another click while asking me. Yes, I can hear your question, but if you take another click, we can look on the same, now you understand what you're looking at, and now we can, I can hear your question.
Well, I only wanted to say that you did an amazing job cleaning those, that layer of stones for the photo.
Yeah.
That's hard.
So many days, so many hard labor and workers that were engaged in this mission. But yes, finally, we could clean in between all these rocks. And you see that it, you need to understand that this is another layer. What you can, and we did not touch any of these stones as is. And while understanding that they were sealed by other layers of dirt and organic material, etc., etc., immediately you can see that there is a step on the right side of the photo. You see that, so you let your eyes go from left to right, meaning from east to west, and then it drops. This drop bothers us a lot. We were trying to provide some sort of an answer why this step was a part of the stone layer. At the end, making a long story short, it came to us. I must admit, this is not my understanding. People who came and shared with us their understanding explained the meaning of this step. With your permission, take another click. Do you see the section?
Yeah, that's beautiful drawing.
Okay, so what you see here is on the left side, you see the different layers of the glacis that we looked at a moment ago. On the glacis, you see the layer of rocks.
Yep.
They are sealed by the layers that I told you that were excavated by us. Now, The lower part of the graffiti is deliberately chosen by the people who are responsible for this feature at 15 degrees. This is how they started, and they picked exactly the degrees later to enlarge the degrees, sorry for the broken in English, but you understand my meaning, into 30. And they could do so by this layer of stones and with this step I told you a moment ago. And while having this layer of stones with the step that we looked at a moment ago, and then they were all sealed with another other layers of the glacis, this is what eventually brought the glacis into 30 degrees incline. And I was explained by expert probably, and I'm quoting now, I have no understanding whatsoever, that this, you cannot have even 1 degree more than 30 to be functioning and kept on this feature, because this is the maximum that such feature could stand, 30 degrees. And this is exactly what we achieved, or these people achieved, with the layer of stone. So they started with 15 layer of stone, and this layer of stone with the step, and then covered and sealed by more layers. This is exactly what brought the 30 degrees. And now it was very simple. What we had to do, take another click, red arrow leading upward, eastward, and this is exactly what the calculation that we had to do to understand at what point or at what height the glacis met, originally of course, the tower or the city wall. So with no other apologies, because I started with so many apologies, take another click, and this is the reconstruction by our artist. It is far more in degrees, but it makes the job, because you understand what we are trying to tell you here. The glacis, take just one more click, you see the yellow and 9.5. The glacis covers 9.5 meters of foundation, be it city wall or a tower in this case, that were buried under the glacis. So you can have your imagination run freely to calculate how high the actual wall or tower was, with this calculation having 9.5 meters as foundation only. And of course you remember the thick layer of plaster that I told you earlier that covers the entire thing, and you now can see the whole picture with the Tyrobone Valley to the right side. And with no questions, I can go to Donna's area now, and another click, guys, you see the coin. Somebody said yes, we see the coin.
Yeah, you can see the beautiful,
okay, you see the coin.
Beautiful coin in the title.
Donald can do work much better, and I guess he has much more to contribute on this side. But, and I'm here taking this side from Donald's presentation in another occasion. We shared together the same presentation. And according to Donald, and later on Donald will probably correct me, now we are talking chronology. On the upper part of the glacis, dozens and dozens of such coins of Antiochus VII were uncovered. The chart here on the right side is here to tell how many such coins were excavated that far in Jerusalem entirely. You see the different excavation areas ever excavated, and yeah, see how many coins were collected by us,
yeah,
at the very beginning, at the very start of the excavation. We just send, without understanding what we are excavating, as a routine, we send a bunch of points to Donald, and immediately we got, guys, stop, something is going on here. And you see the number. And I guess we have at least double or more such points once Donald complete the accounting and cleaning, etc., etc. And this is something that he will probably address later. Okay, so just telling you what is on the upper part. Dozen and dozen such coins, they are the latest to be found. On the upper part, that was, hopefully I will convince you later, that was deliberately evolved and dug and went out of use by someone. On these remains, such coins were found. Now, if you'd like to ask, are the later coins that are also present there in the assembly so far, and this is again Donald's field to tell us if yes or no, as far as I know, no other later coins, later than Antiochus the VII, were uncovered. Just making the story short, because it takes us too long, take another click. And of course, we were trying to understand not only the end of our story, but also the beginning. And for the beginning, we excavated the remains in the lower part, in the lowermost part of the glacis. Because if really the whole thing is one project, it didn't took very long between starting and ending of this project. And the coins that were retrieved from the lowermost part of the glacis, two groups of coins were sent to Donald in different occasions, different seasons. Again, before we understood what we excavated, it was kept by Donald, and there was no rush. We were waiting with these coins, but then when we started to play with this interpretation, I rushed to Donald and asked Donald to give us the dating for these coins. The earlier coins, not the earlier. Earlier coins consist in the lowermost part of the glacis, Persian, as you can see, the large coins are Thelmite coins, of course, but the latest coin in the lowermost part of the glacis are Antiochus the IV. And Donald will say much about the coins later on, okay? So in the lowermost part of the glacis, the latest coins are Antiochus the IV. On the uppermost part of the glacis, Antiochus the IV. Let's take another click, and let's do it very quickly, because this video feels tight, and not much to me to contribute on this side here. Not 100, 150, approximately, such handles were excavated by us, only in the Givati parking lot, mostly from this context. And if you take another click, you see just a group of such handles that were grouped here together for the photo. It tells me something about the reason behind the presence of so many such handles in the city of David Hill. It is not only us, more than 2,000 such handles were excavated so far in the Givati parking lot, most of them by the Shiloh expedition. We had our share here, 150 or so, from this very context that I just mentioned. Earlier, they of course also speak chronology, and it fits completely what I told you earlier, that
Doron, could I ask a question?
Yes, please. Maybe I can breathe it well. Yeah.
my question is, are the stamped amphora handles, all these imported amphora handles, from the lowermost part of the glacis?
No, most of them from the upper part of the glacis. And this is also something that I must say here in advance. We need to understand the end of the story correctly, because we don't really understand the so many finds. With your permission, take another click. Is a story there, you know. We are still trying to study, analyze, and understand the story of the end of the story, because many such beautiful arrowheads that were collected from this context. And again, what are these arrowheads do there at all? Because if they are found inside, it is a question. But they were found just spread all over the glacis. Everything that I'm showing is from the glacis. Nothing came, of course, from the foundation of the city wall or the tower. Everything is from the glacis, on the upper part of the glacis. Take another click, you see all these.
Everyone has the presentation? Yeah, we don't have the presentation.
What happened?
So we don't have the presentation on remote.
Did it all of a sudden go away, David?
Yep. Just the last slide here.
Something is wrong, guys. I don't hear you well.
Hold on, Doron. David Karevich said that your presentation disappeared, so we're trying to make it come back so that everybody
I hope it just disappeared, not an hour ago, and nobody said something.
No. Yes, it was just fine until this moment. No. David, do you see it now?
No. It's loading.
Yeah,
I have it.
Okay.
Yep, I think I have it.
You have
all
it?
All right, yeah.
Everybody else, are you still okay?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, we're on to the, what are they, sling bullets? They look like sling bullets.
Just a moment.
Okay.
Okay, sorry guys. Okay, I'm with you. Can we continue?
Yeah, we can continue. Are we on the sling bullets?
Okay, so you see what was collected from this context. Everything together speaks very clearly and brightly in one language, because also in terms, I think you know much better than I do about this time period, but in terms of chronology, they all fit to the same horizon, so to speak. Arrowheads, take another click to see them with all marks that appear. By the way, Dr. Guy Stieber is working on the military remains, and hopefully we'll get some results soon.
The sling bullet that we're looking at on the screen now, the one on the left, is that the thunderbolts of Zeus? That's what it looks like.
I barely hear you. Can you ask me again?
I'm asking you whether the sling bullet on the left, so we're looking at two large pictures of sling bullets.
Yeah.
And I just want to know if the one on the left-hand side of the screen carries the thunderbolt of Zeus.
Yeah, exactly. By the way, this is the same feature. These are not two.
Oh, one, it's the back and front.
One is with this and the other with the other. It's the same thing. You can see, hopefully, yeah, you see the numbers on the right side of each one.
Oh, yes.
Same object.
Right.
It is the same object.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't look at that. Yeah, got it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, so take another click, and then you see just two and two. By the way, arrows are also marked.
Yeah.
And all together while holding them, and I again admit I'm the least expert here to say something about the arrowhead, but just holding these arrowheads, you see the quality. And talking to Stieber, even though he cannot guarantee that it was really so, he thinks that if judging by quality, it gives him the impression that the uni that was left here in inside whatever it is, be it the Akra or something else, it is one professional unit judging by the quality of the military that they left behind. Okay, so if we're taking another click, I would like to, sorry for, I don't, if you see the, something with G, I was trying to write in English and it came in Hebrew, I don't see if you, ignore it, it's not area G, it should be the Givardi parking lot, okay? So you see again the Givardi parking lot, and now we are trying to tie all the loose ends together. So you know where the Givardi parking lot is located, and now you need to bear in mind only the remains that I mentioned, meaning city wall, a tower, and a glacier on this side, exactly where the arrowhead points. Now take another click. And you see where the Givati parking lot in Hebrew, of course you all read Hebrew, so you see where the Givati parking lot is located. You're looking, you're facing east, of course. You see where area G is. You all know where area G and what area G consists of.
Yeah.
And you see that all together, if you take one more with your permission, another click, 65 meters.
Wow.
Separating between the city wall on the other part of area G and our city wall in the Givati parking lot. Because remember that our city wall was aimed to be aligned with the upper part of the city in terms of topography. Remember bedrock, before the bedrock slants steeply westward. So this is why the arrowhead in yellow stops there. It is where the city wall runs. This is the point. 65 meters separating between the two city walls, the one that you all know on the upper part of area G, and the same thing mirror on the other side in the Givati parking lot with our city wall. Because once the city wall, the fortification line in our excavation was excavated, immediately we ask ourselves, okay, if we have one line of fortification here, it should be parallel with what? Fortification line on the other side, because it must meet another fortification line, of course, on the other side. And we have, as you all know, Middle Bronze Age, Iron Age, these two are excluded, and we are left only with the Hellenistic fortification line on the upper part side in the east. And if you take another click, you see a canyon, you all know this photo, a canyon's excavation. You see a French one that she opened that runs all the way down. This is where she found all the fortification line. The one on the upper part, of course, I don't need to tell you, was excavated earlier by Duncan and McAllister on this part, and later by Canyon and, of course, Igael Shiro. Take another click. Now you see it all. You see, I hope. Tell me if once you don't see, tell me that you see all the yellow noting here. On the left side, you see the Southern Hellenistic Tower. I guess everybody agrees it is a Hellenistic Tower. The Hellenistic Wall. By the way, I'm using Igael Shiro definitions here. The upper part, you see the Hellenistic Wall.
Uh-huh.
And you see the Northern Tower before it was dismantled by Lazar. But you know the Northern Tower. And as you mentioned correctly, there is a Hellenistic glacis.
Okay.
You see the Hellenistic glacis. If you take another click, you see it closely. Take another click. And you all know these photos that were published in Kedem 19 by Igael Shiro. And I guess some of you know these remains closely because you guys, some of you were part of the excavation here. And you see that this is almost a mirror photo compared with the one I showed you earlier on the western part of the hill in the Givati parking lot.
Right.
The only thing that is missing here is the physical connection between the sea and the city wall or any other element of the fortification to the left, meaning be it the tower or the city wall, it was cut by Duncan and McAllister, but obviously they belong together. I'm taking another clip, and you see here this, the guy on the left side is standing on one such layer of plaster.
Yeah.
And that I showed you earlier in the Givati parking lot. But excavation, see the remains on the upper part, we have the same photo. So, summarizing, for those of you who are trying to make any sense, we have the same facade on the eastern side as we have it on the western side. Obviously, it is part of the same enterprise, building enterprise. Take another click. I'm almost there, trying to rush as much as possible. Again, some of the Kedem 19 that was published by Gail Shiloh. I'm using his terms, the Hellenistic lattice and the Hellenistic wall on the right side. And you see the McAllister excavations that originally cut the connection between the two, but as Gail Shiloh noted, and I guess that also a Kenyon in her 1974 book, Digging Up Jerusalem, also had the same comment that they belong together, the glacis and the city wall. Today, according to our result, we know definitely that it is part of the same project. And I'm taking another click, and I guess you can ignore this one as well. Take another click, guys, leave this one apart. Now, what you're looking at is a plan. You see the Givati remains. Now we are trying to address all fortification remains that could be part of maybe the same of the same project, the same entity. So we have the Givati. We have the Area G remains. It doesn't matter now if you add the Northern Tower or if you like to dismiss the connection here, it doesn't matter, but you are still featuring city wall and a tower that were built on the uppermost part, just before a moment before it dramatically steeps to the Kidron Valley on the east, and this is the same photo on the west, just a moment before the bedrock falls dramatically to Akron Valley. Now, we even took it one step further, and we suggested, counting on the measuring and everything else of our surveyor and drawer, that it is well connected with Crawford and Fitzgerald remains. You all know these features. They are known as maybe a city gate or a gate in the wall. And we were trying to suggest a different interpretation. Take another clip. We all know Fitzgerald photo here of maybe yes, maybe not. In the wall. Uh-huh. What we don't see here is enormous wall that was deliberately dismantled by Crawford and Fitzgerald. It is well noted and well described in their plan. Take another click. In yellow, and it is, according to their report, it also stood at least 7 meter high. It is the same thing it is correlated with and also abutting the main fortification line in red to the right. The only thing that you should, according to our understanding, dismiss from this photo is the small room in yellow to the left. I'm sorry, with my broken eyes, I can see it is marked here, I guess, 43 or something.
43, yes.
And 43.
Yeah.
It was added according to what we realize while analyzing the report and all the detail, all the data, that it was added later. Just take a quick look to the lower part of the photo. You see the section. You see these walls, how modest they are in terms of foundation. They don't go as deep as the one to the right, which is the original wall. Mm-hmm. And you see the original wall to the right. What I'm trying to say, guys, is this is another tower. Mm-hmm. Nobody treated these remains as a tower. It is another tower. And I guess that the city, so-called city wall, mm-hmm. it is not a city wall. It is just a passageway to the tower from the city inside. Take another clip. Now you understand what we are trying to suggest here. It is the same thing with access from this entity, be it the Akra or whatever you'd like to call it, from the inside to this feature, which is a tower in Crowfoot and Fitzgerald excavation. And I know that immediately you are asking, you would like to ask, I believe, this is what everybody has done when this photo is presented, north and south. Why to end the reconstruction is based on what? We are trying to take the minimum size of this feature. You can take it, you can push it northward if you like, and southward also, but understanding the whole thing as Hellenistic stronghold, and according to what we know elsewhere, such stronghold features also towers at the corner, and this is at the minimum reconstruction in terms of size for this. Again, I'm very, very careful here. You understand why we suggested the Akra, because in terms of agriculture, chronology, and everything else, it speaks in this very language. Mm-hmm. By the way, it was later replaced by an almost structure. Donald well knows this structure, which is Hashmonia. Nice floors, different layers, many coins that all speak in Hashmonian language that was excavated into the glacis. So we know that this entity that we are dealing here is small. It cannot be a city because remember the 65 meters from side to side. See how small, how narrow it is. Remember the dating. Understanding that it was not existent in the Hashmonian period that followed immediately. Altogether, even though we had no luck to find any inscription that clearly this is the only interpretation that we should adopt, still I think that everything here speaks in this language. Now, the last photo, if you may take another click, is the different suggestions all brought together in the free 1980 article before real substantial remains were actually excavated from this period in Jerusalem. You understand why so many different locations were suggested. They all relied on one and one thing only. Flavius Josephus, of course, a statement understood as the Akra looked over the Temple Mount, and this is what led so many people to suggest the location of the Akra in a higher altitude than Temple Mount itself. But I guess that even before we came out with these remains, remembering even Safir 1980 article and summarizing by him, he summarized all the different opinions regarding the location of the Akra. He ended with a clear statement, according to him, that today we should ignore all the different opinions saying that the Akra should be seeked in the north, west, or east, of course, but only to the south of Temple Mount. And according to him, you know that he suggested one location, the other suggested other location, south to Temple Mount. And I guess today, with such substantial archaeological remains that were excavated in the Givati parking lot, and they were actually uncovered on a relatively large area. This is not a small window that was open, or only a bunch of imported small fine remains that were collected by us. We have the whole thing here. And while thinking about the news and how people may treat this interpretation of ours, we were very careful before publishing the result as such. We had almost everyone that could come to the excavation area to share some of our doubts together, trying to see if other people can see these remains and come out with different interpretations. At the end, while seeing that nobody could stand or even try to or suggest a different interpretation, we carefully, what can we do with it, carefully is not reflected in the news, we carefully suggested that even though this is the right occasion to seek the Akra remains. Guys, now it is your turn to speak.
Oh, Doron, thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure, guys, my pleasure.
Gratitude, much gratitude for your patience and your willingness to hang in there while we negotiated all these technical issues. I want to say to everybody here, we're happy here at the in the Boston end to keep on talking, and we understand that this is already going on for a while, so if you need to cut out, you should do so. But maybe since we invited Donald to give his specific input, especially about the coins, we could ask him, and then we can open it up for questions.
Okay, I'm here. I would really like to hear Donald's opinion, even though we share some together. But yeah, by all means, and with your permission, right after Donald ends, I would kindly say goodbye, and it was a wonderful opportunity to share the result of our excavation, Yana Tchekhanovets and myself here with you guys.
Oh, okay, that's great. Thank you, Doron. Okay, Donald.
I actually, some of the information about the coins I mentioned as we were getting organized earlier, I think I covered most of it. There were showed a slide with 60 coins of Antiochus the VII from his area. That was a slide I presented in I think it was over a year ago, and in fact I counted today, and we have exactly the same, exactly double. There are 120 coins of Antiochus the VII in area, which is a very, very large amount. And I'm going to bring my interpretation and say a little bit about coins, and then I really do want to say a word or two about my view of information, even though I wasn't on the site. The number of coins, when I first saw them, clicked for me very, very well. We have the first bronze mint of Jerusalem in the Hellenistic part of Jerusalem. The original Hellenistic part of Jerusalem was the city of David Hill. It made sense that number of coins would be found right near where the mint would have been. Among the 120, there are also unstruck plans. Those are the blocks that were used to strike coins. So another bit of information and support for a mint being there. When that worked for me, I realized there is another mint in Jerusalem. It was found in 1970. It was found in the Citadel area of Jerusalem. So I was saying to myself, why are there two mints? And the obvious answer for me became that this mint in the city of David Hill that we have the evidence of in the Givati parking lot. This mint was in the place where Hellenistic Jerusalem was, and it's a later point. Hellenistic Jerusalem expanded to the Western Hill, and so there was an opportunity to put the mint in what was apparently a better place. Certainly, Herod moved his palace to the area of the Jaffa Gate. Then the mint would be near the inner palace. It would make sense. So for me, it still seemed to work, especially when I saw the fortification. Now, the fortification, Doron and I agree 100%, it's a fortification. The only really question has to do with how many question marks you put after these words. If it were only one alternative, then you don't need question marks. But when we're saying this, when Doron's saying this seems to be the Akra, and there is another alternative, which is that this was the city wall, the western city wall of Hellenistic Jerusalem, which is now called the City of David Hill. Then we have to leave the question marks in place. I saw in the map, and you all did too, a lot of dotted lines between the three elements that create the Akra outline. By the same token, if those three lines just became two parallel lines, then that would be city wall. It is alluring to call the building the Akra, because we've been looking for that building for so very long, and the location is not bad. It's quite good to locate the Akra there. I just want to point out that there's 65 meters separating the two walls, and that sounds like, well, that maybe that's too thin, and maybe it's not two city walls, but some kind of fortress. Unfortunately, that was the size of the city in the Bronze Age and in the Iron Age until a certain point, and then in the Hellenistic period, Persian and Hellenistic period, that was the size of the city. The city was very, very narrow, and there's not too much we can argue about that. When there was a city wall, it had to be that narrow around the City of David Hill. At some point, the city expanded in the Hellenistic period to the west, and the real question is when. If the city expanded to the west at an earlier point, then the fortification line we see cannot be the city wall, and therefore it would be something else, and that could be the Akra. But my impression is that we cannot move the city to the west as early as the time of Antiochus VII. He, in fact, is the one person who besieged the city. And I think that it makes more sense that the city expanded after the Hasmoneans got their act together and grew the city to the west, and not before. Whether it's John Hyrcanus the First after Antiochus VII died, or whether it's Alexander Janaeus, those are the two commonly quoted candidates for expanding the city to the west. Therefore, I think that that although we agree on most everything, and there's so many things that are clear here and need to be essentially, when we come to deciding what those two parallel lines are they connected at the top with a east-west wall, and are they connected at the bottom with an east-west wall? That's where we have to insist on keeping the question marks in place. Akra / city wall question mark. As long as we're on that level, I think there's every reason to be very excited about the find, and I look forward to continuing to work on the coins and the amphora handles, and I think that that's where the hesitation comes that I mentioned earlier.
Donald, can I ask you a question about the amphora handles?
Sure.
What is...
Is there anything here on the other end?
What?
Do you still need me here on the other end of the line?
Yep. We hear you not very well, but...
I hear Donald. I really respect his understanding about his remains. Of course, I don't agree. I have so much to say about the whole interpretation of this project, because two more points just to maybe be addressed by you later when I'm not here anymore. One is that there are pigs' remains inside the Grasid. Okay, this is one. Second, do we aware or know of any other such parallel of construction or fortification? I don't know by who do not suggest is behind the construction of this fortification, if not the one I'm suggesting, that could also be responsible for a feature such as a glacis. I don't know. I'm not quite aware. I guess, guys, maybe you can suggest another interpretation for earlier construction by, I don't know who, Donald suggests, that also can be another parallel elsewhere in this land with the glacis, the whole thing together. But such towering, the way of construction, the glacis, the remains that are, okay, we don't think the remains should be attributed to the attackers. So let's leave these remains outside. But at the fourth point in the bottom of the glacis, and pigs remain inside, I don't know. This is too much to ignore or to allow us, me, my colleague, support Donald's interpretation. Even though, as I admitted in the very outset of my talk, we have no inscription to fade the shadow behind this interpretation, but guys, You saw it all, you know all the details, and it is now up to you to take your own position or interpretation. Maybe you can come out with a third interpretation for this weekend. I would be very glad to hear, and I would like to take this opportunity again to thank you guys, and I'm leaving you here to continue the conversation here. If you like to ask something, you have my email, you have also the PowerPoint. Just ask me, and through email we can. Hopefully, I can be able to answer your questions.
Doron, I want to say thank you very, very much, and to let you know, if it's all right with you, we would like to post the PowerPoint, and we recorded your presentation. And on the Maccabees Project website, because we have a way for people to write it, so people can continue the dialogue, continue the questions, and you would be able to respond to them if you want, and you don't have to if you don't want to, but so that we can continue this conversation.
Okay, on my side,
that way.
As long as it is only for the sake of this group, and nothing comes out in terms of publication, etc., without asking permission, of course.
I see. Okay. All right.
Okay.
So we will make sure that only the people who have been able to participate in this would be able to view the PowerPoint. We can make that happen.
Great, guys. Okay. I'm leaving you here, and I'm telling you again goodbye, and good night from here, from Israel.
Good night. Okay. Good night. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Okay, other people who have patiently listened to all of this, questions?
Yeah, can I?
Yes.
All right, so I think that I totally agree with the facts that were presented by Doron, meaning that we have fortification, we have two fragments of walls, one on the west, one on the east, and it looks like fortification. Now, the reconstruction that Doron suggests is I would say, vague in terms of northern and southern boundaries. And it can be anything. It can be much smaller. It can be much bigger. So as if it will be much bigger, it could be a city wall, as Doron suggests. And if it would be much smaller, it could be anything else. Now, one thing that I point that I paid attention that the top of the glacis is around 698 meters above sea level. Now, the top of the Temple Mount is 747. That is the top, and above it, we're supposed to have... this fortress would have to be up to, I would say, 60, 70 meters, and I think it's quite problematic for such kind of constructions in the ancient world, and definitely in Jerusalem, which was a very small place. So that's a question mark. And I think we should regard this topic not as only archaeological question, but much more as a question of historical geography. And we should analyze it in this way, meaning what does it mean? How much the description of Josephus is credible, how we can deduct geographical data from the description, and what are the similarities between the description and the site that Doron suggests. So the question is not only archaeological, and I think we should continue discussing it.
David Jacobson, you have some comments, some thoughts?
Yes. I mean, this is absolutely fascinating. I'm very impressed by the presentation, and I also want to compliment Donald and David Gurevich for their critical response, which is constructive as well as critical. There are two issues. One, I would agree, I think we have to leave possibilities open. The walls are undoubtedly Hellenistic. I think we agree on that. The question is, what do they represent? Are they the city wall or the Akra wall? And the answer of Doron about a glacis, well, there is a very good publication by John Granger about Seleucid cities, and he does cite other examples of city walls with glacis in the Hellenistic period. It's worth checking that reference, because in it are lots of other references. Now, I have one problem with two problems with the idea that it's the Akra, apart from the fact that we don't have a northern and southern transverse wall. And that is that I accept David's point that we do have to consider seriously the point made not only by Josephus, but also in 1 Maccabees, that the Akra dominated the temple and could control the temple. And I think it's too low down the hill for that. There's another possible problem, and that is, if the Akra was that far south, what would have been left of the residential part of the city? It would have been even more confined further south, I think, if that is correct, unless it also extended on the other side. So those are the questions that I'm left with, and I think we need, you know, as always in archaeology, more data to help us resolve this. I'll leave it at that.
David, you know, this makes me wonder if it wouldn't be, I would love to see some sort of debate, you know, if there was a forum that we could, maybe the Maccabees Project could help facilitate, but where everybody could write just a paragraph or two, a lot, so that there could be some collection of ideas about this. What do you think?
I think it's a good idea. I mean, I want to just to say that I've come into this as a sort of a gatecrasher into this session. I would like to be associated with this very interesting project, and particularly the debating side and discussion side of it. Let's all put in our penny's worth into this debate and critically evaluate what you know, what one another, what others are saying, to try and get a coherent position to identify what gaps need to be filled in order to further clarify issues, and also to define what progress has indeed been made. But I do feel that it's important to look more widely, if we're looking at Hellenistic, this period, more widely than just Judea and Jerusalem, that we need to look at the literature elsewhere concerning particularly Seleucid towns and fortifications.
Yeah, that's a good point. That is a good point. Are there other people who are online yet who have a question or a comment?
I would like to add a comment to David G.
Yeah, I'm here.
Is that I'm patently not suggesting a city wall only. I really am sticking with ?, and I really think that's the way it has to stay for a while. I want to also say that that Doron hinted that there are 3 meter thick walls, and that he would explain at a future point how that's important. And he has done a calculation which allows him to argue that the superstructure was high enough so that one can look into the temple. Now, I'm not quite sure how he does it, but here's my spin. Again, it's just unrelated, not as a member of the team. One can build a building that's 30 meters high and then build a wooden superstructure where people climb up and they want to look in. They can go another 30 meters with a tower. I mean, these things are possible. So I that's why I didn't reject the Akra, because I think there is a way to understand how someone could create a fort and then go a little bit higher, not a hot air balloon, of course, but go a little higher and be able to see in.
Could I then suggest, as we bring this fascinating session to a close, that we'll keep you posted on our loading of the PowerPoint and the recording on the website, and then let you know how you can write some comments or questions or a paragraph, and we'll figure out a way to collect this information and then perhaps come up with something that we can find some publication venue for, which is a debate about comments on something like this, about these new excavations, just so that many different ideas can be put together in one place.
Sure. I have a question that always lingers for me after these kinds of debates. You know, good arguments have been set forth for a couple of views, and I wonder what evidence would it take to settle the question?
An inscription.
Actually,
preparing myself for today, I actually asked that question to myself, and they're simple answers, but they may not be very encouraging. The support for an Akra would come if there were a northern and possibly even a southern transverse wall found. And by the same token, we saw that there were two opposing walls in the Givati parking lot and in Area G, and Doron is bringing in Crowfort's piece as another. If more pieces were found much further down the hill or much further up the hill, then you'd have a sense that this really is a city wall. And so that one way or the other, the transverse wall or more pieces of a longer wall would give you an answer.
Or a very big Akra.
Yeah, no, that is a good question. All right. Well, thanks so much to all of you for hanging in there. And and I want to say absolutely that the next time we have a brown bag, we will have better technology. And in the meantime, David, we are delighted to welcome you to this this project. And I'll send you a link and ask for you know, so that we can put list you down as a project member and keep you on the mailing list, and we'll be in touch.
Yeah, thank you. And all right. I just wanted to point out that we had people here from North America, Israel, Australia, Europe. It's an amazing thing.
That is amazing. Great for us. Thank you all, and have a nice evening wherever you are.
Thank you.